not have our prepackaged elements, we encourage you to still have, still try to grab a little piece of bread and a little cup of grape juice as well. Our special offering for March is for the Gideons. We do still have some today devotionals available, so please pick one up so that you can continue to hold on to God's word during the season. And last but not least, thank you to all of you who have been submitting the denominational surveys. We still need more people to submit the denominational surveys. It's not one per family, but it's individual. So please, please, please have that available. Please have that and get that ready for us as, if possible. And obviously we have the hard copies as well. So thank you for those of you who will and who have submitted those denominational surveys. The worship bulletin was emailed to you, and it's available at our website. As we come before the Lord and worship this morning, I invite you to follow along with the bolded words. We are like a parched desert, empty and in need of replenishment. Visit us with your presence. Saturate us with your spirit and bathe us in your streams of living water, that our lives might acknowledge and worship you, to the praise and honor of Jesus Christ. Amen. Please join me in prayer. As we journey with you, O holy God, as we continue our way to the cross, sharpen our focus, so that our attention may center more on you than ourselves. Lead us through the shadows of darkness and prepare our hearts so that we might be a people of prayer, ready to perceive and respond to your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. For this is the day that the Lord has made. We are here to rejoice and be glad in it. For this we pray in your holy name, and all God's people say, amen. Amen. I invite us to rise, church, in body and word spirit, this morning, and let's give a little wave or a salute to each other so that we can share God's peace with one another this morning. Let's declare to the Lord this morning. Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Come on, sing it out, church. Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Won't you open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you, I want to see you,
to see you high,
to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Won't you open the eyes of my heart? I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Won't you open the eyes? glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy. To see you high, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
Holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy. We cry holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Holy. Holy, holy, holy. You are holy, holy, holy. Jesus, holy, holy, holy. I want to see.
We'll sing that one more time. Make it our prayer this morning.
Holy, holy, holy. We cry holy, holy, holy. You are holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
Amen. You may be seated. Our God calls us into a time of corporate confession this morning with these words. Ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, offspring of evildoers, children who deal corruptly. They have forsaken the Lord. They have despised the Holy One of Israel. They are utterly estranged. I invite us to look back upon this past week. If there's any sins, any burdens, I invite us to bring it to the foot of the cross in this time of corporate confession. Let's go to God. Hear these words of assurance. Zion shall be redeemed by justice, and those in her who repent by righteousness. But rebels and sinners shall be broken together, and those who forsake the Lord shall be consumed. We've confessed our sins and have been assured of our pardon. I invite us now as one church to confess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. And we say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Okay, good morning. Before I get started with announcements, are there any other prayer requests that anybody would like to submit there, anything written out that wasn't submitted already? Okay, awesome. Thank you. And for those online this morning, I apologize. It seems as though I'm having problems viewing the chat bar with the streaming. So if anybody did make any prayer announcements in the chat bar, I apologize. We will not be doing those today. A little technical glitch, but hopefully everybody can see the service just fine. All right. Well, today we celebrate Communion Sunday. I just want to remind everybody that the second offering this morning will be going to the Gideons. We heard a short word from them last week. Hopefully everybody will find it in their hearts to give a little to them this morning. We have our public reading of scripture, which is still taking place during the season of Lent at 9:30 here in the sanctuary. So if anybody would like to join, please feel free. Just because you've missed a couple of weeks doesn't mean that you can't come next week and just jump right on in. Our youth group will be meeting today via Zoom at 3 p.m. So we encourage everybody in your youth groups to be involved with that. Children's ministry will be meeting today as well at 4 o'clock at the same Zoom address. That has gone out multiple times, but if you do not know the Zoom meeting information, please email Pastor James and we'll be sure to get that to you. Okay, our ladies' Bible study is continuing to meet on Tuesday mornings. The men's Bible study is Saturday mornings. Throughout the respective times, we have ladies' Bible study at 10 p.m. and the men's at 7 a.m., both doing here in person and via Zoom. I hear that the ladies' group is enjoying the use of the new streaming equipment and making sure that everybody's more active and participating, even if they're not here in the building. Our denominational surveys went out. We'd ask that everybody continue to fill those, respond to those surveys so that we can submit them to our denomination. I'm not quite sure, but I'm sure Pastor James can update us after I'm done speaking with the number that's come in so far for that. We encourage everybody to participate in that. Again, it's beneficial for the church with our classes group. We also have our Thursday evening book study continuing on emotionally healthy spirituality. If you haven't joined, again, we encourage you to join in at any point in time. It's something to get caught up on. We do have a couple of extra those books laying around, right? Okay. There is one extra book laying around, so if anybody is interested, please, again, if you haven't participated, just email Pastor James and we'll make sure that you get some of the information for that. We also have our Passion Week Bible verse journey here, where we are crafting a calendar of our favorite Bible verses to lead us in the journey through Passion Week. So we would ask that everybody has an insert in their bulletin today. We would ask that you fill that out. There is a right in front of the newly prepped streaming booth over there, an audio video booth. There's a collection plate over there for everybody to submit their Bible verses into, so we'll be collecting those. There's a couple of blank sheets in there. If you don't have one in your bulletin, you can fill it out there. It only takes a minute, but we'd encourage everybody to participate with that. If you are online, you can just very easily just reply back to the email that went out with today's service information, the bulletins and stuff, and we'll certainly include them in our collections as well. So two ways to do it. You could do it here in the church right now, or if you need some more time or you're at home again, please just reply back to the email that went out and we will most certainly add that to our collections. Okay, and I see there's one here also, a reminder about the snow patrol. I think we are pretty clear of that, so we will disregard that one. However, if anybody would like to pre-sign for next winter, do feel free. We will most certainly catalog that and keep that on the calendar for next winter. Okay, and then there's also a short reminder here about the Easter weekend services. Thursday, April 1st, will be Maundry Thursday prayer service, which will be at 7 p.m. That will be done virtually by Zoom. Friday, April 2nd, Good Friday service will be here in the church at 7 p.m. And then Sunday, we will have our traditional sunrise service, which will be taking place at Hexham Park at 7 a.m. There will be no gathering of breakfast here at the sanctuary due to the COVID situation that's still taking place and the restrictions upon the gatherings. But we will most certainly be having our Resurrection Sunday celebration at 10:30. So again, we encourage everybody to join us over at Heckscher Park. I believe it's, I'm going to say it wrong probably. What field is it? It's field 6. If you've ever been to Heckscher Park, when you go inside, just take the circle to the right and it's... Okay. It might be 5. But and it's the first parking lot you come to after the boat launch. It's very easy to memorize that over the field numbers, since we kind of have a disagreement here. But either way, again, we encourage everybody who's able to come and join us. If you haven't participated in the Sunday sunrise service, it's a brief service, usually runs about 15 to 20 minutes, and that's really just about it there, time-wise. But again, we welcome everybody here online, here in the building, and most certainly those that are online watch us. Okay, well, that's it for our, oh, I got one more announcement, sorry. Yes.
People can either donate funds for it, or if they want to pick up a few Easter baskets, we are in need of 10 more baskets and Easter grass, and also if they want to pick up individually packaged candy or goodies. So we will accept them. We're going to be doing the baskets the following Tuesday, I believe, 22nd. Okay.
For those that are online who may not have heard that, hopefully, I'm not really sure. Just to reiterate real quick, we are doing Easter baskets, once again, to be donated to Lighthouse Missions. We're in need of about 10 baskets and supplies to fill those. So if you have it in your heart to go out and purchase some of those supplies, individually wrapped candies and things that are inside the baskets, the grass, that would greatly be appreciated. If you are not able to or just still uncomfortable with, we would encourage us, just make a monetary donation and we will have that taken care of here through our deacons to make sure, again, we fill those baskets. And then again, they will be donated to, over at Lighthouse Missions. I forgot last year we had done that and I don't remember how many baskets, but we did 50 baskets last year, and we're trying to achieve those goals again this year. So please, we encourage everybody to give to that ministry. Okay. All right. With that being our announcements, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the opportunity to come together once again this Sunday morning to worship you. More importantly, we give you thanks that for those that aren't able to get here to this building, that they can virtually watch us and participate in our services. We pray for encouragement for all those that are participating in our services this morning. We pray for a special blessing and a reminder that you open our hearts to what the season of Lent means to Christians, not only here but around the world, for the sacrifice that was made on our behalf, for the grace then that you've bestowed upon us during this season. We pray also, Heavenly Father, this morning for Cynthia's friend, Roz, who was just diagnosed with cancer. We pray that you'll be with the doctors that are in charge of Roz's care. We pray that you'll also be with Roz and the family as they go through trying times. We pray that you'll strengthen them during this time, and more importantly, give them a sense of encouragement as they go through the healing process. As cancer is such a long and tiring thing to go through. To give them the strength again and the encouragement that they need during this time. We pray for a prayer for Elisa's friend, Fran Ehrlich. Fran passed away on Wednesday, and we just pray that you'll be with her family and close friends. Give them strength during this time. Give them ease their minds. Give them good thoughts of the friendships that was there. And just again, we pray for the family during this time, as you know, dealing with loss is an extremely difficult thing. We pray that the mourning process be filled more with joy of the life they spent together and the good times that they've had, and not so much be spent on the passing of the earthly body here. We also pray at this time for Stan Arthur, who will be going through carpal tunnel surgery this week. We pray that that you give these knowledge and skill set that the doctors have studied so long to just make that a seamless procedure. That you also pray that you give Stan a sense of strength and encouragement to go through the healing process, and a sense of patience as well, as surgery sometimes does take, the recovery does take a little bit longer than we all want it to be. Just that we just pray for that, again, the encouragement that's needed to heal properly so that Stan can get back to his daily life. We pray also for our brother James Costello, who has been experiencing some back pains and stuff that's kept him away from going out and working properly. It's kept him away from coming here to service this morning. We just pray that you'll be with him. Give him strength and encouragement. Just be with him during this time. And just let him, we just pray that he knows that people are here in this church behind him, praying for him to get back to strength and get back to his daily life as best he can. We pray also for Kelly at this time. We pray for restored health as she was experiencing she was at work and was electrocuted and in serious condition at this time. We pray that you'll be with the doctors and nurses that are in charge of her care. Give them a brief reminder of the skills that they've been educated in so that they can work on getting Kelly back to her stable health so that she can not only get back to work but also get back to being around those that love her. We pray also for Faye and Rich Gershio as they're still mourning the loss of Faye's family member down in North Carolina. It's always a hardship to be away from family during this time, so we just pray that you wrap your healing arms around that family. Be with them during this time. And we just pray that you continue to encourage them to remember the good times that she had with her parents during the childhood. As so many more memories come to her, especially during this time with the passing of both of her parents now. We also pray for a special blessing of your spirit. Be with Pastor James as he delivers your words to us this morning. May all our hearts and minds be softened to receive this message this morning, to be encouraged and enlightened during with what we are about to hear. We also pray, Father, and give you thanks and praise for the leadership of Pastor James and Jin during this time. May you continue to encourage them, strengthen them, and just be with them in everything that they do as they lead us in your ministry here in East Islip. And Father, we give you, again, special thanks for the work of the Gideons as we celebrate them with our Deacons Collection this morning. May you give them the fortitude to continue to deliver your message and your words of your kingdom to all those that are touched by the work they do. We give you thanks and praise in your son's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Just a shout out for our online congregation. Just another reminder, you are not just watching a video. You are worshiping the Lord, united in the power of the Holy Spirit. So let go of all distractions and really really be prayerful. It's not just watching a video, but you are worshiping together this morning. So good morning to you, Carl and Luana. Good morning to you, Carol. Lee, I know you wish Riverhead was closer. I wish so too, but there's a lot of potholes and traffic between here and Riverhead, so praise God for technology. Good morning to you, Rich and Faye, and Michael. Good morning to you, Sedalia, Sue, Islan, Jess, Yvette. Good morning to you, Shane. Big hugs to you, Lynn Olson. Good morning to you, Gina Schinkel. Good morning to you, Gene Burkle. Frank family, good morning to you as well. And I'm sure I'm missing a couple more, but good morning to you all worshiping together this morning online. And for those of you who will be worshiping at a later time through the archive, good morning and good afternoon and good evening to you. Before we dive into God's word this morning, I just want to share with you that one of our council members decided that it would be very awesome to share our favorite Bible verses as a church family. And we just we decided we're going to craft that into a prayer calendar for our Passion Week. So if you don't mind filling out your favorite Bible verse, and also for those of you worshiping online, like Ed said, you can respond to the worship email that goes out weekly, just with the reply, and just share with us your favorite Bible verse that means so much to you. And then I'm going to be crafting that into a prayer calendar, and I'm going to have that ready for us for Passion Week, so that as we go through Passion Week, we can be prayerful together as a church family. And I pray that that brings us together more united as a church family as we proclaim Christ gathered or scattered. You're going to get sick and tired of me saying this a whole year, but... But anyways, before we dive into God's word this morning, I'd like to invite us in spending a moment of silent prayer. Many of you know loved ones that were lost too soon because of this virus. Some of you have had this virus, and it's not fun whatsoever. Some of you have been on the front lines fighting this virus and with the vaccination efforts as well. And all of us have experienced some form of loss in one way or the other. So as we approach this one-year mark of this pandemic, as your pastor, I can't stay silent. I can't just brush it across. I need to lead us in a time of lament. We need to grieve. We need to mourn. But as we lament and grieve, we need to say thank you, Jesus, because it's in those headaches and the heartaches that the gospel is needed. We could not have come this far if it wasn't for our Lord. So wherever you may be, whether it's grief, whether it's frustration, anxiety, the list can go on, loss and ambiguous loss, I invite you in this moment to come to the Lord in silent prayer, to just bring it to the cross and to bring it to the Lord. And after about 30 seconds or a minute or so, I will close this in prayer. One year ago, we had no idea what was happening. We had no idea what would have happened. We had no idea. Didn't know who to trust. Didn't know what to trust. But God, you knew, because you are the creator of heaven and earth. You knew because you are the ruler of all. But Lord, it's through this pandemic we have experienced tremendous loss. Loss of normalcy, loss of a routine, loss of loved ones, loss of in-person corporate worship, and the list can go on. But it's through those losses we have been humbled and reminded of how important the gospel of Jesus Christ is. We have been humbled and in awe of how the Spirit of the Lord works even amid a pandemic. So this morning, Lord, we pray prayers of petition. We lift up those healthcare workers, the frontline workers, the essential workers, those working to create the vaccines. We lift them up to you, O Lord. We lift up those educators who have had to change their lesson plans probably one too many times. We pray for all the students across our nation and the world that were forced into remote learning and in isolation from their friends. We lift up those that are hurting in their grief of a lost loved one, and even those that were unable to say farewell. We lift up our government leaders to you that had to make decisions beyond decisions that impacted so many people. But most importantly, Lord, we pray with thanksgiving for Jesus Christ. Because it's in those dark days, those lonely days, that we are reminded once again how much we need you. So we thank you for the gospel. We thank you for that gospel hope. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. Thank you. God is good. And all the time. We turn to the book of Jonah once again this morning as we journey through our series that I've entitled Following Jesus to Uncomfortable and Unexpected Places. So I invite you to turn to God's Word this morning. This morning's Word comes to us from Jonah chapter 2, verse 1 through 10. Jonah chapter 2, verse 1 through 10. Scripture reading is available on your screen and in front of you, as well as your bulletins. So if you're there, I invite us to rise in body or in spirit so that we can honor the sacredness of God's holy word. Let me read this for us. And Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God, from the belly of the fish, saying, I called out to the Lord, and out of my distress, he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight, yet I shall again look upon your holy temple. The waters closed in over me to take my life. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped about my head. At the roots of the mountains, I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. When my life was fainting away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love. But I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you what I have vowed. I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. And the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah out upon the dry land. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Please join me in prayer once again as we ask God to illuminate our hearts. Lord, our God, we humbly come before you this time as we open up your word. Speak through this unworthy vessel so that these words can encourage us, challenge us, embolden us for your glory's sake. For this we pray in your holy name, and all God's people say, amen. Last week, we witnessed God at work on this ship, changing and transforming the hearts of these pagan, non-believing sailors, even in Jonah's rebellion and disobedience. We learned that God is bigger and more powerful than what we can ever imagine, and that he can do in his will. So as the sailors threw Jonah off the ship, Jonah was probably thinking, in a state of surrender, this is it. I'm done. Here we go. Geronimo, here's the end of my chapter. I'm finished. But even before he gets thrown into the water, we see the Lord at work. Jonah chapter 1, verse 17, and the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now, the passage we read this morning starts us off where Jonah is inside the belly of the fish. And here we see this prayer of thanksgiving for being saved. Now, this clearly is not a prayer of petition, and Jonah poetically testifies of God being at work in this moment. When the sailors threw Jonah into the water, Jonah realized as he was getting into the water that he really didn't want to die. Even though he was the one that said, throw me in. Jonah chapter 2, verse 2, I called out to the Lord out of my distress. Out of my distress. And he answered me. Now, distress in the biblical Hebrew is often translated to fear of death. Fear of death. The fear of death that took over Jonah. It doesn't necessarily mean that Jonah died and rose again, but that God clearly heard his cry for help and went to his rescue. If you finish up verse 2, we see Jonah testify, "Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice." Now, in Scripture, Sheol is oftentimes referred to as the place of divine punishment, a curse often wished on the ungodly. So if you think about it, Jonah is acknowledging his place. He's acknowledging his sins and disobedience. He's acknowledging the fact that he should not deserve this saving from God. He's admitting that he did wrong. And that sounds awfully familiar with what we have today. People are afraid to admit their mistakes and acknowledge their shortcomings unless their backs are up against the wall. Can I get a witness? We've seen people. Maybe we have been there. And as we unpack Jonah's prayer this morning, I believe Scripture is teaching us some important reminders in regards to this prayer that Jonah prayed. And first is this. Jonah prayed to the Creator God. Jonah prayed to the Creator God. Verse 3 in our passage, "For you cast me into the deep." It wasn't the sailors that threw him into the water. It was God. God was behind the action. The Lord pursued Jonah with his wrath. Jonah is in the belly of this giant fish, not by chance, but because the Creator God did this to him. God, who is in control of all, handpicked that giant fish to pick him up. The Creator God placed him in that situation where Jonah's sins are acknowledging the wrath of God. Now, most cartoons, Sunday school cartoons, probably tell us that there was this big giant whale, this big giant fish that was ready to gobble Jonah right up when he gets thrown into the sea. But that wasn't the case. God's wrath pursued Jonah. Verse 5 in our passage, "The waters closed in over me to take my life. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped about my head." Jonah describes here what happened as he was drowning. He probably felt the fear of, "I think I'm going to drown. I think I'm going to drown. I'm struggling. Help." He was probably struggling to stay afloat. He was probably grabbing any and every ocean vegetation as much as possible in that moment. But can you imagine being in that moment? When we are drowning with doubt, when we are drowning with uncertainty, thinking that we're going to go to that dark valley of death forever, rather than praying prayers of petition, "Save me!" Can we pray prayers that acknowledge our Creator God first? Rather than, "I need help," can we say, "God, you are my God," in that moment of desperation? Can we pray prayers that acknowledge our Creator God first? Our Creator God that reigns forevermore. Our Creator God that rules the heavens and the earth. Rather than "save me" in that desperation cry, can the first words be, "God, you are the Creator. God, you are my ruler. God, you are the one who is still sitting on the throne." My cousin shared with me this quote. My cousin, who's a minister out in the Seattle area, shared with me this quote, and it's this. "God might bring deliverance that saves you from your present difficulty, but he might not. Because you don't trust deliverance. You trust in God. You don't trust in deliverance. You trust in God." Second reminder is this. Jonah prays to a faithful God. Jonah prays to a faithful God. And Jonah's hopelessness and despair, God saved Jonah's life, and the repentant prophet confessed that indeed that the Lord was his God. And verse 7, we see, "When my life was fainting away, I remembered the Lord. So thinking back the other week when we learned how Jonah was not your stereotypical prodigal son, but that he was already a well-trusted minister of the word before he went away, Jonah clearly knew the power of God. And one of the most powerful attributes of God is that he is faithful and just. But when we forget about praying to our faithful God, and we're so focused on a quick fix solution, get us out of this pandemic, God. It's been 365 days and we're still in this pandemic, technically. But we're so focused on this quick fix solutions and answers, you see, we end up creating idols. We did a book study on counterfeit gods last year, and Pastor Tim Keller says this, an idol is whatever you look at and say in your heart of hearts, if I have that, then I'll feel my life has meaning, then I'll know I'll have value. Then I'll feel significant and secure. Church, if you continue to raise idols as your saviors, you are rejecting and rebelling against God's faithfulness. If you continue to raise idols in those quick fix solutions and answers, you are raising idols that prevent you from worshiping a faithful God. If you reject God's faithful love, you will continue to create idols in your heart, and that cannot happen. That's a complete disobedience and rejection of God's will. Colossians 3, verse 5, put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. Sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. These quick fix solutions and answers that we want are an idol. The more excuses we put up in front of us saying that we can't be a Christian because we're not good enough, that's an idol. We can't serve in church because we're not good enough, that's an idol. And that's what we learn here through Jonah's desperation cry in verse 7. When my life was fainting away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. No lifeless idol can go up against our Creator God, the ruler of heaven and earth, and the faithful God who has showcased his steadfast, loyal, and covenant love. The third reminder is this. Jonah prays to the Savior God. Jonah offers a sacrifice of praise and glory to the true and providential God. And Jonah commits to obedience, not because he was just saved from death. He doesn't say, oh, thank you for saving me. He says, but because salvation belongs to the Lord. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Salvation and deliverance only comes from the Lord. We're so hung up about finding those quick fix solutions and quick fix answers. God, 1-800, God, hello, I need that answer right now. We're so hung up about that. We're trying to find the answers. We forget that the answer is already God himself. John 14:6, Jesus declares, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jonah declaring that our God is the Savior God lays that groundwork for this connection that we see to the Messiah, the Savior, Jesus Christ. Matthew 12:40, for just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of that great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Jonah's expected death didn't occur, but God's sovereignty shined in that moment. You see, God preserved Jonah. So what can we take away from Jonah chapter 2? A good pastor friend of mine shared with me this example this past week. Because I said, oh, I'm preaching on Jonah chapter 2 this weekend. He said, well, what's your big push? Well, I just wanted to unpack Jonah's prayer. And he said, well, you got to tell your church family that you got to be the fish. I said, what do you mean? Well, he said, when God said, come, the fish came.
When God said, spit them out, the fish spat them out. The fish was probably one of the most obedient creatures in this world to this day. But as we were talking, he said that the story of Jonah and the connection that it has to the story of Christ should be the ultimate evidence that indeed our God is a powerful God. When God crafted these scriptures, everything fell into a place, in its place, for the right reason at the right time. What happened during those 3 days and three nights for Jonah? Jonah was under God's wrath because, why? He deserved it. He was the rebel child. He disobeyed and he went against the Lord. If you think about it, as we are in the season of Lent, Jesus Christ was under God's wrath on the cross. Why? Because of us. Because we are the rebel childs. Because we disobey. Because we go against the Lord. Because we create idols in our hearts and in our lives unbeknownst to us. The purpose of God's grace isn't necessarily to save Jonah. And many times we misconstrue and we misunderstand and we think God's grace was there to save Jonah. But that's not the case, church. God's grace is to use Jonah, even in that rebellion, even in that rejection, to bring others to Christ. That's the grace that God still works. That's the grace that we've learned in this pandemic, where there are so many people, right, not to get political, but there were so many churches that were frustrated with capacity limits, with this and that, or the government can't, has that overreach, the government can't tell when the churches can meet or not. But at the end of the day, church, what I'm so proud of our church is that we learned, rather than letting that things of the world sway us, we learned to proclaim Christ whether we're gathered or scattered, amen? We learned that, you know what? We might be in a situation where we're scattered, but that doesn't mean that we're not going to proclaim Christ. It means that the Sunday morning hour is not the only important time that we have. We learn as a church family that every single moment of our lives, as we're gathered and scattered through the power of the Holy Spirit, we are called to proclaim Christ. And guess what? The Spirit of the Lord worked. I'm proud to announce that we've had new members during a pandemic. We've had professions of faith during a pandemic. We've had baptisms during a pandemic. Does that not mean anything to us? The Spirit of the Lord was at work in our hearts. And if we can't acknowledge that God is still at work, we're missing the point. That God was still at work in our hearts and in our lives. God's grace isn't necessarily the saving part for Jonah. God's grace is to use others to bring to Christ. God's grace isn't necessarily, he saved us from this pandemic. God's grace is that he reminded us over and over again how much we need Jesus and how important it is to proclaim Christ, not just when we're gathered, but also when we're scattered. God has been at work. The purpose of God seeking to save people drowning in sin by sending his son Jesus Christ to live, die, and rise again for us. God seeks to save people drowning in sin by sending his son, Jesus Christ, to live, die, and rise again for us. So God's beloved that trusts in Jesus will receive mercy like Jonah. And that should lead him to never be the same. Receiving God's mercy, let alone in a pandemic, should lead us to be in a place where we are never the same. Wow, I thought church had to be like this, and I thought Bible studies had to be within the four walls of the church building. But my goodness, thank you, Jesus. I learned that the church can be like a rushing wind where we can do church together no matter what, because the most important thing is I got to keep proclaiming Christ. That's my testimony. And I learned that everybody over the age of 75 in our church family are Zoom experts. Hallelujah. And I love that one of our senior saints told me a few months ago and said, guess what? The world can't cancel out church. I said, why is that? Well, we can still do Bible study over Zoom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That God still works, that his grace and his mercy for us isn't just, oh, he saved us from this pandemic, but that he was teaching us over and over again, like he's doing for Jonah, how people can come to Christ over and over again. Receiving God's mercy should lead us to testify like this, that we see here, that we can never be the same. Our hearts should be overjoyed in thanksgiving for the gift of salvation, not just once a year during the Hallmark calendar days of Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday. Our hearts should be overjoyed in thanksgiving every single moment of our lives, that death and that resurrection should happen every single moment of our lives as we wake up in the morning and testify God's mercy is new every morning. That should get us going. Because God's mercy, like he showed unto Jonah, changed Jonah, and Jonah was never the same. God's mercy unto us should change us where we can say we are never the same. We learn through this prayer, this testimony, that indeed our God is our Creator God. We're reminded that he is faithful and just. We're reminded that he indeed is our Savior. So as we approach the table this morning, may we be reminded of the power of the gospel, that gospel hope that can carry us forward once again. Let us pray. Our God, we pause in awe of you. We pause in awe of you because, Lord, you are the Creator. You are our faithful one. You are our Savior. But, Lord, we also confess that there have been one too many times where we have forgotten that. There have been one too many times, Lord, where we have taken that for granted. So, Father, as we approach the table, Lord, we pray that you can remind us and humble us over and over again. Through the power of your love, through the power of your grace, through the power of your mercy. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. The Lord's Supper is a celebration of God's grace, not human achievement. It's a means of grace through which God acts to seal the promises of the gospel. The power of the celebration does not lie in our ability to think hard about Jesus' death and our sin, but in the way God's Spirit uses the celebration to nourish and sustain us. The Lord's Supper is a gift. And at this time, I invite you to have your communion elements in front of you and follow along with the bolder words in this response reading as we approach the table. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right for us to give thanks and praise. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray. Lord our God, send your Holy Spirit during this time so that this bread and cup may be for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. May we and all your saints be united with Christ and remain faithful in hope and love. Would you gather your whole church, O Lord, into the glory of your kingdom. For this we pray in your holy name, and all God's people say, amen. The bread that we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share the same love. The cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. The cup that we drink is our participation in the blood of Christ. Church, the Lord has prepared this table for all who love Him and trust in Him alone for their salvation. All who are truly sorry for their sins, who sincerely believe in the Lord Jesus as their Savior, and who desire to live in obedience to Him as Lord, are now invited to come with gladness to the table. Church, the body of Christ given for you. Church, the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Loving God, we thank you for feeding us in this sacrament. We thank you for uniting us with Christ and giving us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and to work to your praise and glory for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. For this we pray in your majestic and glorious name, and all God's people say, amen. I invite us to rise in body or in spirit as we respond to God's word and the Lord's table as we sing together the hymn, Go to Dark Gethsemane. Seated. Our special offering for March is for the Gideons. As always, you can, for those of you worshiping online, you can give through a Venmo or Zelle, or you can always send a check to the church address. Please join me in prayer as we lift up our offerings and tithes to the Lord. Our God, we thank you for the miracle of the gospel. We thank you that we have the privilege to witness the impossible become possible. We thank you for the work of the Gideons as they continue to share the power of God's word near and far. Lord, we pray that as they share those testaments to those that need it the most, Father, we pray for empowering. We pray for emboldening. We pray for uplifting. And we pray for health and protection. Father, we pray for our offerings and tithes we give unto you this morning. We pray that you may multiply it and magnify it, not for our sake, but for yours alone, so that we can witness the gospel being proclaimed, not just in our state, not just in our nation, but throughout the nations and the world. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. I invite us to rise in body or in spirit once again, wherever you may be, as we worship the Lord with the new doxology and end our worship with the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you a peace beyond all peace, now and forevermore, and all God's people say, amen. Amen. God bless you.